Hi, I'm Dennis VanDerGinst. Join me in a series of entertaining and interesting conversations with entertaining and interesting people. We'll explore various aspects of the human experience and what makes life more fun. This is Uncommon Convos. Thank you all for tuning in. I'm your host, Dennis VanDerGinst, here with the effervescent Dana Watkins. And before we get, I had to come up with another word for you today. Before we get started, I'd like to remind you all to please subscribe, rate, and review our podcast if you like us. If not, then don't worry about it. Also, check out uncommonconvos.com to leave comments and suggest topics and guests. Speaking of guests, we have a great one here today. My friend Bobby Hansen's here to talk basketball and business. Bobby is currently a regional director for the Better Business Bureau. And in his former life, he played basketball for Lute Olson and the Iowa Hawkeyes, where he graduated in 1983 as the 10th all-time scoring leader in Iowa history. He then spent 9 seasons in the NBA, mostly with the Utah Jazz, but finishing his career in 92 as part of the Chicago Bulls championship dynasty with Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen. In fact, Bobby spurred the comeback in Game 6 of the 92 finals against the Portland Trail Blazers when the Bulls came back from 15 points down in the fourth quarter to get Bobby his NBA championship ring. And I think that still stands as the largest comeback in NBA finals history. In addition to his responsibilities with the Better Business Bureau, Bobby's been a longtime color commentator for Iowa basketball broadcasts. And Bobby, as we're recording this, we're right in the middle of the NCAA tournament, so I am really grateful for you to be here with us today. How are you doing today?
Yeah, hi, Dennis. Hi, Dana. Doing good. Wish we were still playing. This is the Elite Eight day. we're doing this podcast, and had high hopes for the Hawkeyes that we'd get past Oregon, and then the game would be, I think, tonight. USC, but they had an opportunity and had a great year. Regardless, Luka Garza was phenomenal. So it's all good.
And we're definitely going to talk about that quite a bit more. But as we get started here, I kind of alerted you that the first question that we were going to have to launch the podcast was going to be from you to you. So what kind of what's the question you want to ask yourself?
Yeah, there's a million, right? and I thought about it after reading it. I haven't come up with a good one, Dennis, but I had a nice long lunch with a good friend of mine, and I think the last time we were together was before the pandemic. So I guess my question is, what did we just go through this past year? Everybody. I mean, it affected every single human being on the planet. How did we get through it? How did we survive it? What did you learn coming out of it? And as we talked at lunch, I said, I think we learned that we need the human interaction of people. Maybe the first couple of weeks and, staying home was good, but you go stir crazy. Luckily, Mary and I live out in the country and I could get out and we could walk around the pond and go outside and enjoy that. But I hope we never have to go through that again. And on top of that was, during this past year was the windstorm, the derecho that hit Cedar Rapids. So it really affected, got the double whammy around here, the businesses. And it's still a mess over. You see it, Dennis. You have your office over there. That whole area got crushed over there. And it wasn't like a tornado, where one area of town would have gotten nailed. But it was, the whole 60-mile wide swath of destruction. But I guess the question was, what we learn out of it, and what did we become better people? I think so. I think more productive, more efficient in your production at your work, and you had to find ways to get it done. And I think the human spirit, they got it done.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, people had to be creative, that's for sure. As we're doing this today, we're obviously in different locations. But we're able to get it accomplished. It's not that kind of contact that we'd probably prefer to have, but at least we're creatively able to get it done. So that's great. So I want to lay the foundation here for those listening in who aren't familiar with you. I know that you played ball in Iowa at West Des Moines Dowling, if I remember correctly. And you won the 4A state title at that point. And then you went off to Iowa. So were you recruited elsewhere? Why did you decide to go to Iowa?
Yeah. Dennis, I think being home state, I'm from Des Moines, went to West Des Moines, Dowling Catholic. And at that point, you know, your recruiting process is a lot different than it is now, where kids are making decisions earlier in their careers. My decision to go to Iowa came all the way down to after done in high school, after we won the state championship. So Iowa had won the Big Ten title the previous year. And I guess for me, I didn't know if I could play at that level, to be honest with you, Dennis. I mean, you're always going to doubt a little bit, but I was never one of these overly confident people that go in there and set the world on fire, but knew that they were good and had a great player in Ronnie Lester, All-American point guard. Now it's like, where do you fit into this structure? So I was looking at, you know, the homeschool with Drake. I kind of wanted to get away from home a little bit. Every 18-year-old kid wants to. Marquette was coming off a national championship in 1977. So I took a visit up there, and the campus just did not compare to the University of Iowa and Iowa City. It was more of an urban city campus, beautiful in its own right, but it was in the city. But just like, no. And then probably Texas A&M, believe it or not, was where I was heading. And at that time, you know, there were a lot of recruiting perks and all that went along with what they were doing down there. And sounded good to me. When I went to tell the coach or ask the coach to come up and tell that to my parents, my parents said, no, over my dead body, you are not going. That kind of put the end to that. Yeah.
That was probably a good thing, right?
Yeah, that was probably a good thing. So, Lute Olson, you mentioned Dennis, was a coach, Hall of Fame coach now. He's such a presence. And at that time, was really making a name for himself. And he did the recruiting, would come to the games at Dowling. So he put the call in to me, you know, okay, we got to know here, you know, scholarship offer. Here's what you get. I thought, wow, coach, I'm really having a hard time with this decision. Can I have a little bit of time? And he said, you bet. And we're on the phone, right? I'm at the kitchen table. And I said, well, how much time do I have? He said, you have 10 seconds. And then I have to know.
Yikes.
Yeah. Dana, put the hard sell on you. Yeah. At 18 years old, you know, the air goes out of your head. And I'm like, okay, I'm coming to Iowa, coach. I don't want to let this opportunity pass up. So
smart.
My father was a big Iowa fan. He loved the Hawkeyes and I knew that he would approve of it. He really liked Lute Olson. He liked Coach Olson, thought he'd be a good coach for me, in your maturation process. And it worked out. It worked out great. Yeah. Great group of guys. And we had a good run there before.
Yeah. Wait, in fact, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, that's
Dana.
Okay. Isn't Iowa, University of Iowa, like one of the top five party schools?
I think it has been voted. I don't know if it's ever reached.
Pretty sure.
Had nothing to do with it.
Exactly.
Yeah, we were disciplined athletes, Dan. So, but I think you're right. Yeah, it's a fun place.
So speaking though of that choice, it turned out to be a great one. Your freshman year, you made the Final Four, and that, in fact, I believe that's the last time I was in the Final Four, and only the third time ever. So. What kind of that had to be a crazy experience as a freshman, because you were getting playing time freshman year, and all of a sudden as a freshman you're in the Final Four. How was that experience?
Yeah, crazy experience. And we were one of the last teams, guys, to make it into the field. We became a 5 seed in the East region, and the 4 teams ahead of you were all nationally ranked: Georgetown, Maryland, Syracuse. Iowa were the 4 in there, and I can't remember who the other one was, but they were all expecting to go to the Final Four from our pod, from our area. So we got everybody healthy. We had a lot of injuries that year. I had a broken left hand, had to play with a pad on it. Ronnie Lester's bad knee. You had Kenny Arnold had a broken thumb. We only had 7 available players, really. Everybody else was injured and couldn't play. Mark Gannon, my roommate and best friend on that team, blew his ACL out early in the season there, so he could not play. We lost an assistant coach, Tony McAndrews, in a plane crash. He went down in a serious plane crash on the banks of the Mississippi River.
Oh my gosh.
And it would burn badly and bruised, and he survived and he's doing good. But we lost a coach in the middle of all that. So it just taught you resilience and taught you to come together as a team. We didn't go real hard in practice because we only had seven guys.
Yeah.
But you just advanced. You just took it one game at a time, one day at a time. Luckily, we got into the NCAA tournament. As I said, one of the final teams in, at-large teams in. But, went down to North Carolina and beat Virginia Commonwealth and then knocked off North Carolina State in their backyard, which was an upset. And then we marched to Philadelphia and knocked off a higher seed in Syracuse pretty easily on a Friday night. And then we find ourselves down 14 maybe at halftime early in the second half against Georgetown. And guys all came together and we scored 9 out of 10 possessions in the second half and played good defense and won going away at a shot at the buzzer and a free throw 81-80. So at that point, that's when it's like, wow, we're going to the Final Four.
Yeah.
And it was a wow moment because the year before is what I consider the, the rebirth of college basketball with Magic and Bird.
Sure.
In the 1979 Final Four that they had. So now all the attention goes to 1980. We were in Indianapolis, and there we were right in the middle of it all, and ended up not winning on that Saturday. We lost to the eventual national champion, Louisville Cardinals, but they had a phenomenal player, Daryl Griffith, who became a teammate for 7 years. In the Utah, great teammate, great guy, but great memories from that Final Four year.
Well, and then, obviously that had to have been incredible, but then you got even, more playing time and more attention in the course of your career there at Iowa. And I believe every year that you were at Iowa, you made the tournament, didn't you? And I know you went to the Sweet 16 your last year.
Yeah. I mean, we lost to Villanova 55-54 down in Kansas City. A couple of missed free throws in there and just heartbreaking. But that's the year Lute Olson left as well, right after the game. Mm-hmm. He accepted the position down at Arizona and rebuilt Arizona basketball. So, got to enjoy 4 years at Iowa, got my degree in business and marketing. And then it's off to what are you going to do with the rest of your life? And, had that foundation of the Hawkeyes and Coach Olson and your buddies, right? I was ready to get into a career of banking at that time in 1983. Banking or insurance?
Yeah.
A good friend of mine, Gary Kirk, was just starting up Kirk Van Orsdale Insurance Company, which has since been sold out to Marsh McLennan. But he had said, hey, if it doesn't work out, then, come work for us here in Des Moines. So, it's kind of like the main thing was to get to graduation in the spring there and then drafted into the NBA in June.
Yeah, and I want to talk about that. But before we leave the Iowa playing career, what was it like playing for Lute Olson?
It was an awesome time. Lute was a gentleman. He was a player's coach. He was well prepared. Your scouting report was spot on every time. And now just was go and execute. But the beauty of what Coach Olson and how he coached that team, put together the team, was the guys, he didn't want any knuckleheads coming in messing with the chemistry of the team. So you were recruited by the current players, a lot like a lot of schools do now. And they take them out. They want to know, is this guy going to mesh in there? So I think number one, Luke picks his guys to be a part of this team. And I think it's pretty common knowledge. Luke never swore. I never heard him use a swear word in my 4 years, 6 years that I knew him through the recruiting process and even after that. But that's just the type of guy he was. He's a dedicated family man, married to Bobby Olson, his high school sweetheart. She ends up passing away of really, really bad cancer down in Arizona. But she was a second mother. We would take recruits out and then it'd be breakfast on Sunday morning. She'd be making apple pancakes and you meet everybody up back at the house. So that's what the experience was playing for Lute Olson. And he took that down to Arizona and became a national champion, Hall of Fame coach down there with the Wildcats. So no, it was a decision made in a 10-second time span. I'm glad I came to my senses, if you will, and said, I want to be a Hawkeye.
That's awesome. Great. And I was going to ask what some of your fondest memories were, but I think you just kind of told us some of those. Who would you say was the best player that you played with at Iowa? I know you mentioned Ronnie Lester, Yeah. Would you rate him up there, or who else would you?
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely, Dennis. Ronnie was an All-American that injured his knee. He tore some cartilage early in his senior year and was really never the same after surgery and going to the NBA, and just the knee continued to bother him. But he was the best guard that I ever saw, best point guard that I ever saw. Just quick, stop on a dime, rise up above taller players, shoot the shot. Came from poverty in the south side of Chicago, down by White Sox field and the projects where Kirby Puckett grew up, down there, the Robert Taylor homes, which are now flattened, right. Redoing that area off 35th Street. But that's where Ronnie grew up, and just a humble person, just a wonderful teammate. So I'd say Ronnie's the best. And then after that, Vince Brookins came in from Cleveland. Vince was a phenomenal athlete, under-recruited. I was talking to him about, what's going on in the world and, the inequalities and all that. And how Vince never saw color. This was a kid that was stabbed in the heart when he was 14 years old in a race riot in Cleveland. Yeah. A very visible scar on his, right over his heart, plus the open heart surgery. And, Vince was a great friend and a fantastic shooter. And in that run to the Final Four, Vince never played better in his whole career. He was phenomenal. He was a member of the All East regional team, but I'd say Ronnie won. Vince was number two right there. And then Steve Carfino played a professional career in Australia. Steve was a great little point guard that came in from California, but we had a lot of guys. And Kevin Boyle, a real good friend of mine he's from Chicago, St. Lawrence guy. He was an all Big Ten freshman player his freshman year, made the all Big Ten team. So Kevin, I guess those guys won 2-3.
Yeah. You had the Twin Towers your last year, didn't you? Michael Payne and yep. Greg Stokes. By the way,
Greg Stokes.
I played against Michael in high school. He was a year or two behind me. One of the most embarrassing moments in my career. He stole the ball from someone, and I went to defend him as he went down court. It's him on me, and just boom, right over my head. He posterized me. And
there you go.
The only thing that let me save a little bit of face was he was called for traveling beforehand. But this was down at Quincy, The crowd was going nuts because Quincy is such a mecca as far as high school basketball. But they had a great career too, obviously there at Iowa.
Yeah, Michael, great guy. I follow him on Facebook. That's how old people kind of get connected now. But Michael and his family living out in Maryland are doing very well. And Greg Stokes up here in Cedar Rapids. Yeah, I forget about Greg. Those two were the second set of Twin Towers. Yes. First set we played with was Steve Waite and Steve Craftsison. Waite makes the shot against Georgetown and the free throw to send us to the Final Four. But both those guys were 6'11", big towers on the inside. But Stokes and Payne were talented offensive players as well. But that's a good memory, getting dumped on there by Michael.
I don't know about that.
If he remembers it.
So who were the best players that you played against? You mentioned Daryl Griffith, who you did play with the Jazz. Anybody else that stands out in your mind when you're in college that you would say, oh my gosh, those guys were just amazing?
Yeah. Hakeem Olajuwon from Houston and Clyde Drexler. We were down there and we played them. Some guys from Arizona State, Fat Lever was on that team along with Byron Scott was on that Arizona State team we played. UCLA, they had a bunch of really good freshman guys, my age, Darren Day and Rod Foster, Michael Holton, all went on to play in the NBA. Joe Barry Carroll at Purdue, a long NBA career. Sure. God, just too many to remember them all. I mean, the Big Ten back then was loaded. Jay Vincent, Sam Vincent. I missed Magic by a year. He left after his sophomore year. Greg Kelser, long NBA career there. Just a ton of them. Can't come up with all the names. But
sure. Well, you mentioned after your senior year, you get drafted into the NBA and third round of choice, 9-year career. By the way, I looked this up. That's not too damn bad to have a 9-year career, especially a third rounder, the average career, according to Wikipedia, is 4.8 years. So, you doubled on that. Absolutely. So, and as you mentioned, your first years were spent with the Utah Jazz. How was that experience? I know you played with some great players there too.
Crazy, crazy experience. Number one, Dennis. Yeah. They don't have a third round anymore. So, you know, very lucky to even, you know, be invited, I guess, to try out into the NBA. But yeah, it was the 7th pick of the third round, pick number 54. They now have two rounds, 30 picks each. So 60 picks, but was chosen by the Utah Jazz and a team that wasn't doing very well, but needed players. They had the leading scorer in the league in Adrian Dantley from Notre Dame, who was coming back off injury. They had Daryl. You had Ricky Green, who became an all-star my rookie year. Frank Layden was coach of the year that year, but it all came together. And again, the power of teamwork, if you will, and you just do your job. My role was to play a little defense, maybe hit a three-pointer. I'm not going to play a whole lot during that year, but played some important times, and you got to perform during those big moments. But we won the Midwest Division. That had never been done by the Utah Jazz. They were an ABA team that won the ABA title, but once they merged, they were always at the bottom of the NBA in the West Coast. So we really kind of elevated that. Frank Layden, like I said, a phenomenal New York coach, mm-hmm. came in with a great sense of humor, loved his players, deflected all the pressure and attention away from players, put it upon himself, and had a good run there. They had Jerry Sloan, the Chicago Bull Hall of Famer, legendary player, was an assistant at first, and then he became the head coach when Frank went up. But I was just hoping to make it through training camp. Was in shape, trained in the altitude to go out to Salt Lake and play in that altitude. But it just worked out. I was cheap, minimum rookie salary. Yeah, that helps when the team is, you know, looking at bankruptcy, I guess.
Sure, yeah.
My rookie salary was $45,000.
That's crazy.
Playing in the NBA. Yeah, it is nuts. And you look now, I think the minimum for rookies is $500,000.
Oh, my gosh.
But I wasn't complaining. I was not complaining, guys. Right. So it's just great to have that uniform on with that logo on the uniform and do whatever it takes to become a part of that team.
Well, you know, and Frank Layden, I think, was an amazing coach and executive for a long time. And as you mentioned, I think Jerry Sloan came on near the end of your run there with Utah, if I remember. Yeah. Or did he coach you?
Yes. Jerry? Yeah. He was an assistant for right from the beginning.
Yeah.
And then I think he 4 years into it, Frank, we had new ownership. Larry Miller purchased the team. Right. Here's how times have changed. People understand money. Larry Miller bought that two installments. First one was $8 million. The next year he paid $12 million to Sam Battistone.
Wow.
and his father, $20 million for the team. And Larry passed away a couple of years ago. He was a great owner, fast pitch softball pitcher, was a parts guy for Toyota and started his automobile empire. Now, I don't know, I got 300 and some dealerships now, but Gail Miller and the family sold it a couple months ago for $1.5 billion.
Oh, holy gosh. $20 million.
Yeah, that's the way these teams have increased in value.
Sure.
Now that includes an arena in there as well, but it's still just an incredible trip.
That's crazy.
But yeah, that was years spent with Frank in Salt Lake. Two of our children were born out there in Salt Lake City, and just a beautiful, beautiful city. And we loved it in the summertime just as much as the wintertime. You go hiking and fishing and riding your bike all up and down the canyons. Sundance Canyon, Robert Redford's resort out there was awesome. So just fell in love with the state of Utah.
Now, how'd you like playing with Stockton and Malone out there? Obviously, yeah. Hall of Famers, great teams when everyone was gelling out there. What was that experience like?
Yeah, John came in the next year after my rookie year. They drafted him in the first round. He was part of the Olympic 1984 Olympic team, and him and Barkley did not make the cut. That's kind of when people first started to notice, you know, Gonzaga and what John Stockton is. And
right.
as I tell the story, I think Frank drafted him as a backup to an all-star, Ricky Green from Michigan, Ricky all-star year the previous year. So they drafted John quickly. The first couple of days of training camp, I think some of the passes that he made and some of the plays that he made, you can see that they're like, this guy's not a backup. He's a starter, but fierce competitor, John is. To this day, he probably still is one of those gym rat guys that goes out and plays basketball. Think about him a lot when we see Gonzaga having the run that they're having right now. Reacquainted with John, had kind of not talked to him. He was one of the first people to call me after we won the world championship. How he got the number, I have no idea, to the apartment in Chicago, but he was one of the first ones to call. Carl Malone right behind him, consider them friends. Carl and John, my wife and daughters got a hold of a lot of guys and asked for video. Happy birthday. I turned 60 a couple months ago. So they had this crazy surprise video and got to see a lot of those guys.
So, nice.
Brought a tear to my eye, made me laugh, made me smile just to see those guys and bring back some great memories. Carl doing great. Down in Louisiana. He lives outside of Ruston. He told me 6,000 acre ranch. Come on down and do some hunting and fishing down there with Carl. So he had a recent scare where his wife went into septic shock from trying to pass kidney stones. Yeah, she's much better now, but he was telling me he had to race her to the hospital. Luckily they weren't too far outside of town, but yeah, crazy times with those guys. Grew up. It's almost like we grew up together.
Right.
When you're 21 to 30 years old, that little short time frame that you have to be a professional athlete.
Yeah. And you were there for what, seven years or so? Or
I was there for seven, and then traded to Sacramento. I was on the golf course with my wife, and we were at Larry Bird's golf tournament in Indianapolis. And guy came out at one of the young pros and said, "I got an urgent message for Bobby Hansen." And I'm like, "Uh-oh, something happened to the kids." We had two little ones at that time. My parents were watching, and it had 801 area code. I'm like, "Uh-oh, we've been traded." It was right before the draft. So at that point, you're like, "Where are we going to trade to? Philadelphia, Boston, LA, New York, one of them?" And they're like, "We're trading you to Sacramento."
So no. Like,
what does that feel like?
What is that? I was only there a year. They were trying a rebuild process, had four first round draft picks. They were going to take all those young guys, mix them with some older veteran guys and see what they could shake out, but didn't work out so well. And I was at the end of my career. My body was given out. Had shoulder surgery out there and knee surgery, nothing major, just cleanup, cartilage in both spots. Had good doctors at UC Davis. And then I was just like, "Well, you know, can you trade me back to the Midwest?" I know this is going to be the end of my career. So I would never do that. But just sometimes you feel strong enough that, okay, I'm going to do this. So the general manager and I, Jerry Reynolds, had a good relationship from knew him for a lot of years. He said, "You know, I'll do that for you." So he said, "Chicago, the Bulls are here looking at you." And I went, "Really? The Chicago Bulls? Not the Durham Bulls or somebody else?" No, the world champion Chicago Bulls. And I went, "Wow, who do they want to trade?" He said, "They want Dennis Hobson, one of the young guys, and not playing a lot. You're backing up Jordan. And he wants to, you know, break free a little bit." So I said, "He'd be good out here with these young guys." So it took a few days to get the deal done. When I got the word, I was on the next plane out of there, put all my stuff in my car and put it in storage, and then flew to Chicago. And you take the physical, you land late at night, early morning physical. And then here you go to the practice facility, and they were just finishing up practice. And I was just getting there to meet the coaches. And first person I run into is Michael Jordan. So it's kind of like, okay, we've been wrestling, fighting for 7 years here. Now we're gonna continue it right here in the hallway or what? But he stuck his big hand out and said, "Welcome to the Chicago Bulls." Looked me up and down and said, "Get rid of the shoes." I had LA gear contracts. I had LA gear shoes on. I'm like, "Okay, they're gone. Give me some Nikes." He said, "You want some like I wear?" And I said, "No, I can't wear Air Jordans, but give me some like Pippen's got." So he was my shoe contract, old Michael was. And whenever I needed him, he had him, gear, whatever. He had a direct line, I guess, somewhere to Nike.
I'm sure he did. Well, Dana, you were starting to ask something. What was that?
I don't know how the trade process works, but so what I gather is the first time you were traded, it wasn't your choice, right? It just kind of happened.
Say that again, Dana. I was adjusting my speaker.
Oh, no worries. When people are traded, athletes are traded, I always wonder what that feels like, especially if it's a surprise or it's not their choice.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the second one was my choice. You're right. The first one, we were a little bit bitter, I guess.
Yeah.
I knew it just for the job. Nobody wants to be traded from their job. They come knock on the door. Oh, we traded you to, the contractors union or something.
Sure.
There's a certain amount of bitterness. And I think for Mary, my wife, they kind of get left picking up the pieces, mm-hmm. to move the house, move all that, though the NBA does all the moving for you. But it's still, your kids have friendships and you have friendships. And we were firmly entrenched in Utah. We were there for 7 years, had a home there, had a condo, had a home, then had a home, and then just loved living there in the summertime. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, see you later. We'll trade you to Sacramento. So it was tough. And you got to know the guys in Sacramento. There were a couple of the veterans I knew from basketball. Antoine Carr was a good guy from Wichita State. Antoine was a buddy out there. Wayman Tisdale, who's passed away, he was the star out there. You kind of find your group, find your guys. And I got hurt early and didn't play a lot out there. But again, the body wears out. And luckily, it got me through one more year there. My ninth year was short.
But at least that was your launching pad to the Bulls.
Yeah.
And nice way to end your career with a championship ring. I'm sure you've seen The Last Dance, right? The series about the Bulls run. So from your experience with the Bulls, was that a fair depiction? Is Michael really that kind of a slave driver and everything that you was reflected in that series?
Yeah, no, I would say. I always had a good relationship with him because we wouldn't talk a lot of basketball per se. He's a golfer, as you know, and I like the golf. There was a lot of stuff come out, of his, playing for big money, golfing. I was just like, damn, man, how do you lose $100,000 on that golf course? I'm mad if I lose $20. He said, you're playing like a 15 handicap when you have it. 7 handicap. I said, well, you got to have a higher handicap then, dude. But we would always talk a lot of golf and different courses. So he never, I was older than he as well. It seems like in The Last Dance, I was only there 1 year or two. I wasn't there in that final stretch. I was there at the beginning.
Right.
Those were young talent, Michael, young Scottie Pippen. Those guys were young thoroughbreds, man. They just wanted to, beat the tar out of you, opposing team. So that common ground that we had to beat the opponent, that was that locker room. And Phil Jackson as the coach, it was so brilliant at inspiring and making him think outside the box with his Indian folklore and conversation we had to start. Practice was not at 8 o'clock in the morning. Practice was at 11, knowing the value of rest and, late nights the night before. So Phil had a really good handle on the group. He always liked to call it. And if something started to go away, he would pull it back in right away in this meeting. We read from a little journal each day, just a daily thought, and we'd discuss it. Just a lot of different topics and gun control to whatever, alcohol, driving while drinking and just different things and get guys, make them open up and think about something other than themselves in basketball and to kind of connect the group together. Bill Cartwright, phenomenal as a captain of that team. But what I didn't like about The Last Dance, guys, was the portrayal of Jerry Krause, the general manager. They kind of
he didn't like it either.
He didn't like it either. Yeah, but he liked it. Jerry liked it. That get in the locker room and they kind of make fun of him, but it was kind of all in jest. But sometimes it went pretty hard, and nothing I could say and get away with. He'd cut me, but Michael could get away with it. But I always liked Jerry Krause. He tried to trade for me while I was playing in Utah. So he always kind of, they're putting this group around Michael. He couldn't have all of his guys. You know, he had to have some different stuff. So Jerry made a bold move and got an old guy in me to come there and be a part of that team. And so I am forever grateful to Jerry Krause of that. And a lot of those guys are, I know, but it seemed like the popular thing was to pile on there, but it seemed like he took a bad rap. But anyway, that is what it is with that. But Michael liked to challenge the young guys. And what you saw, I think, I can't remember the kid's name, that he was always trying to motivate. Michael had a motor that ran 1,000 miles an hour all the time, 24 hours a day. The guy lived on, you know, 2-3 hours of sleep and just one of those individuals that is driven. Don't know what it is that drives him, but he's a driven person. But yeah, just to be a part of that, Dennis, you have good days and bad days. Michael seemed to be a guy. He and Scotty and I would do a lot of 3-person drills together, and he could tell if you had a bad day, like, hang in there, man, we're going to get you a ring. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to hold you to it. So in the end, when we won, we had that comeback and was able to be a part of it and subbing in for Michael. And I ended up with the game ball. Paxson had thrown it up, and I'm like, okay, this is college education for my children someday. Yeah, I knew I couldn't keep it. So as I got it down in the locker room and sat there with Michael, I'm like, you want this basketball, man? He said, you bet. And he grabbed it and took it. And he went and chased down the next three or four. So he has 5 of the 6 basketballs. And it's important, I guess, when we're doing our 3-person shooting drills, I asked him one time, I was like, where is that first basketball when you guys beat the Lakers out in L.A.? He didn't say anything. And Scotty's kind of laughing. I'm like, where's that basketball at? It's got to be somewhere. It's got some historical value in Chicago. And Scotty's like, I got it. And I looked at him and went, why do you have it? And why doesn't he have it? He said, because I got it. And I went, okay. Well, I got the next one. And I said, I got to give it to the man. Got to give it to Michael. So, yeah, that was a fun moment. And one of my lasting impressions is when we were over, we were celebrating champagne and all that down the locker room. And Phil whistled. He had a great whistle. Phil Jackson did. He whistles everybody in and says, hey, they want us to go up on the, he asked me first, said, they want us to go up and celebrate on the floor. What do you think? And I said, it's Chicago. Let's go. Let's go back up. So he whistled everybody in. Let's go back up on the floor. So Michael jumps up on the scorer's table and he's got the basketball in his hand and dancing to Queen, We Are the Champions of the World. What a great way to end it. I kind of knew right then that was going to be my swan song, and what a great way it would be to go out like that. And
absolutely.
Yep.
That's cool.
Absolutely. You know, and you mentioned, first of all, Phil Jackson, another one of my personal heroes as far as coaching and sports go, and the way he coached, the way you've kind of described that. Where do you put him as far, because you've obviously played with great coaches. How do you compare the coaches that you've played for?
It's hard. I have been lucky. You're right, Dennis. All the way back to, I had a great youth coach, John Morrow. He's a Polk County supervisor forever and ever, and involved in politics in Des Moines. But he was the first one, and I say that because he was the first one to throw me out of the gym for not paying attention. And,
wow.
So yeah, kind of set it straight right there. You know, 7th grade is like, you're in here, you're going to work. So, you know, my father would not want to hear any of that. So that was hell to pay, I guess, when that came down. But, you know, Johnny was the first one. And then John Labonia, my high school coach, made me a guard. I was a center in high school. So he saw that you're not going to play center at Division I basketball. You're going to have to learn, you know, play facing the basket. So I've already been doing that in summertime and that. So he put me in that position. And then Lute Olson, obviously a Hall of Famer. I mean, you can't argue, but they're all different. And then Frank Layden to Jerry Sloan, who ruled with an iron fist and you know, just toughness, you know, grab your lunch pail and put on your hard hat, and nobody cares about your troubles, and nobody cares about if you're sick or hurt, that you show up and you go to work. You owe it to these guys. That was Jerry Sloan, his philosophy. And then you go, Dick Motta was a little bit like Sloan. He was a Hall of Famer in his own right in Sacramento. But then Phil Jackson, and he was different than all of them because of the way he connected as a former player with the New York Knicks, a free spirit, you know, a hippie, well-documented, you know, Phil traveling the country, hitchhiking in his right. early days and getting the job. So, you know, that was fun stuff to talk with Phil about. And one of my best friends in the NBA, Rich Kelly, played with Pete Maravich at Stanford graduate, Stanford MBA. Rich is very intelligent, but he was Phil's roommate while they were together in New Jersey Nets. So we had that connection. So Phil always would, you know, seek out, you know, your thoughts. Like I said, ask you, should we go up to celebrate on the table? So Phil was always in communication, knew that if, you know, a couple, you wouldn't play for a week straight, he'd try somebody else in there. And he always made a point to say, you know, stay ready. I'm going to use you. I'm going to use you in the Western Conference Finals because you know these teams. I said, I'm ready, coach. Staying ready. So his connectivity to the players, I think, what separates him. Also, you know, the people he had around him. Tex Winter.
Tex, yeah.
Was of the triangle offense. I think really was totally different than what Doug Collins was running for Michael. Everything was structured. Everything, you call a play out, 15, 17, 19, whatever the play might be, where the triangle offense doesn't have any play calls. He had one, which involved an obscene word and kind of like called it as a sideline play. We call it what the F. And everybody was supposed to look around like, I don't know what the F, whatever. It was a back pick dunk up to the basket. So that's the only play call we had. Everything was predicated on where the pass went. Never throw it to the corner. You reverse the basketball around, use that high post on the backside. And then you got tremendous talent. Well, you know, surrounded with Michael Jordan, Scottie Pippen. I mean, two of the greatest of all time.
For sure. And then I'm going to put you on the spot here a little bit. I mean, you mentioned Michael and Scottie, two of the greatest. I think, you know, most people, when they're talking about the greatest of all time, they're going to throw Michael in that mix. And, you know, depending on your age, maybe certainly LeBron and Kobe comes into that discussion sometimes. Who would you say is the greatest player of all time? Not including Michael.
Yeah, for me, it's Michael Jordan. No doubt, yeah. Just to see, you know, work that he puts in. Relentlessness, you know, refused to lose, refused to die, never lost in the finals, 6-0 in the finals. Just people came at him when you could beat him down. I mean, the bad boys, the Detroit Pistons, used to take cheap shots at him and just beat these guys down. Michael never backed away from that one bit. But I like LeBron. I'm going to be quick to say that. I think what he's done is amazing. Just the body that he has and the good work that he's doing as well. Sure. Putting students through college, you know, getting them in that high school, what he's done for the city of Akron. I think it all comes into play. You mentioned, you know, it depends on how old are you. You know, Oscar Robertson, the guy averages a triple-double. Jerry West, Kobe Bryant. Yeah, I mean, there's so many. I mean, that's your Mount Rushmore of all-time greats in the NBA. At my position and at the time, the two-guard position, the big guard, shooting guard, there were some phenomenal athletes from Walter Davis, Clyde Drexler, Danny Ainge. I mean, was playing. Dennis Johnson passed away, Boston Celtics. Every team had a scoring two guard, and my job was to try to slow them down a little bit. But different game back then, guys. It was a really physical, hands-on game. Now it's like you touch these guys. And that's why Michael, if he played under these rules right here, he'd average 50 points a night. Before he would wear out. But yeah, it's just, it's completely different.
And it's funny, you know, mentioning Michael, one of the things that struck me when I was, you know, preparing, obviously I'm familiar with Bobby and his career and all that, but you know, when we go into these podcasts, I want to be a little bit more prepared than just a conversation. So, I knew at the time, but I had forgotten that you had participated in the 3-point contest in the All-Star game with Michael and Larry, who finished last and second to last in that contest. Ironically,
you do your homework, don't you, Dennis?
That's good. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that was 1990.
Yeah.
Yeah, 1990 or 89. We were in Miami. I know that. They're playing the Miami Vice music. That was your minute you had. to shoot. Yeah. So Stockton would help me. John would set up the racks, and after practice, we would practice that. We'd play the music and do that. But yeah, I was invited 87. They go by your stats, and my percentage was pretty high. I didn't take a lot of shots, but it was above the threshold, and you're 50% at that time. But I was invited to shoot in Seattle, where Larry Bird had won in 87. I think, you know, he didn't take a warm up off, but he won that. But Mary and I had set up our wedding day during the All-Star break. So it was going to be publicity for Utah, and they wanted us to move the wedding to Seattle. I said, that's not going to work, guys. So I've got to turn it down. So luckily I was invited once again in 1990, and it was a treat. I finished fourth and got $2,500 for finishing fourth.
Nice.
Craig Hodges, a future teammate in Chicago, had won. Reggie Miller was second. John Sundvold third. I was fourth. But yeah, you're right. Michael was seventh, and maybe, I don't know which.
He might have been last.
Yeah, I think he was last.
Yeah. I think he got five.
He came. Yeah, he was frustrated. He became a better three-point shooter as the years went on. But our lockers were, you know, at the time, we're together. We're near each other. So he comes in, and the press is waiting for him like they always are, and just surrounding him. And, you know, you could tell he wasn't real happy. He was a competitor. But he sat down and looked over and kind of gave him a head nod. And I said, what are you going to do with your shoes? He said, nothing. You want them? I said, throw them over here. So he took them sweaty shoes off his feet and tossed them over. And I'm like, all right, I got my first pair of Air Jordan. These are comfortable.
Gross.
And
that's the kid's tuition too, right?
Yeah, they're locked away, no doubt about it. But after about a minute, I'm looking at them. You know, they got these funky little shoelace clip on them. He's like, you need some help there? I said, you know how to operate these? I said, I'll figure it out, Michael. Thanks. But he was a great teammate, and just, you know, his kids, and to see his kids now growing up and all that, I think it's awesome. Now he's a young dad, second time around, with a couple of twin girls. So we get a chuckle out of that when we all get together and laugh.
Yeah. Now, you know, after 9 years in the NBA, what was it like to go through retirement? I mean, that's the end of that career, college and high school and all that. That's got to just be just surreal.
Yeah, it is. And I kind of knew, guys, that it was the end. I did not have a contract and, you know, didn't do anything special, you know, lead the league in scoring, whatever, but you kind of want to keep going, maybe get that 10th year. My wife's father was dying of lymphoma, cancer, old Marine veteran. And it's like, you know, you need to be with your dad for the rest of his days, however long that is. I'll take care of their two little ones the best I can here while you're at the hospital. So it just dragged on into October. And then they called, like, come back and, you know, we'll pay you what we paid you last year. I'm like, if you just guarantee it, I'll come back. But they wouldn't guarantee it. So I'm like, you know what? I'm done. That was a great way to walk away. It's never easy. And you mentioned this. What made it easier for me was that I got into the radio, started doing the Hawkeye games right away. Jim Zobel invited me to sit in with him on a December weekend tournament that the Jerry Strom was doing the games, and he had to do more coaching responsibility at that time. So sat in there with Jim, and it went well. And then did not do any more games the rest of that early season. Had non-refundable tickets and all that from Mary and I had a vacation planned in January. And night before, Chris Street gets hit by the snowplow. Tragic accident. Yeah. And kind of got the word there. And we're flying out the next morning and missed it. Saw it from a distance over in where we were at vacationing. And then when we came back, they called because it's an incredible emotional victory against Michigan State. WHO, it wasn't all Learfield IMG College like it is now. We were a separate entity. So WHO said, hey, can you do the game? You're playing number 2 Michigan, I think, on Sunday. 1993 in the Fab Five. So we did the game, and another huge emotional victory. The team marched the basketball over to Mike and Patty Street. They were sitting courtside there. Just Jim and I are tearing up, crying, hugging each other on the radio post game as the Hawks had this incredible win. And WHO called that Monday and said, "Hey, are you retired?" And I said, "I think I am." I said, "Well, do you mind? Would you do the rest of the season with Jim and Jerry?" I said, "Yeah, I'd love to." So I haven't missed a game from that point forward, from that Michigan game. I've been through, Jim and I did 5 years, and now Gary Dolphin and I just finished 24 years and have not missed a Hawkeye a game on the road or at home.
Wow.
Calling the basketball game. So that made the transition a lot easier than it would be. And everybody goes through it. My wife would say, all these guys have to go through it. What you miss, and I'll finish with this, but what you miss is not money, and it's not running around, jet setting around the country in different cities and all that. You miss the camaraderie of the locker room. You miss your buddies. You miss your friends and hanging out with them and just doing, playing cards and doing whatever you do. So you never really find that teamwork.
Yeah.
Companies talk about it. People try to replicate it in different ways, but it's never the same as that locker room is inside that athletic locker room, where you have that one goal, that purpose, that one thing that unites everybody, black, white, Asian, whatever it is, you're going to win that basketball game. You're going to dominate the opponent.
Yeah.
That's what you miss.
No, I can definitely see that. Anytime somebody reaches the pinnacle of their profession, whether it's sports or law or whatever it is, I'm always curious as to what it is that has driven them. What motivates them? What gets you, for instance, as far as basketball, into the gym every day? What's that workout regimen like? What was it for you that propelled you?
Well, I'd be lying if I didn't say, you're trying to make money. You're trying to, I made nothing early in my career. But yeah, you're always, and then once you get there, you want to prove yourself. And then at that point with Utah, we were always chasing the Los Angeles Lakers. We could never get over the Lakers and Magic Johnson. It just, but that's what drove you, is to, not be embarrassed when you're out there guarding Magic Johnson. I mean, you want to get stronger. You want to jump higher. You want to become a better shooter, a better ball handler. Those are the things that, I guess you're driven by, you don't want to be embarrassed out there, and can easily be embarrassed and exposed out there on the basketball court. So you just, be the best that you can. Try to keep yourself healthy. So many guys get hurt nowadays. I mean, it just, I don't know if we had the same type of injuries as kids are having nowadays, but so, and then to get traded to Chicago, what drove me there was to make it to the finish line. Do you have one shot in life? I remember telling myself, Dennis, all the time, just keep everything in check, keep it together. And I wanted to maintain my conditioning because I didn't want to be, fat and out of shape, and you sit at the end of the bench and they put you in and your buddies laugh at you. So that always drove me, running around Grant Park and running up the steps. We lived in a high rise on Lakeshore, and I'd run up all 50 steps of them and keep yourself in shape. So I've always prided myself on that. And then to get to the finish line, not many people win their last game.
Right.
For me, I got lucky. You don't win your last court case. Some guys do, but kind of like, this would be a good time to walk away and say thank you.
Yeah, perfect. Now, you mentioned the color commentary being what kind of made it a little bit easier. We talked before the podcast began about this last season and how weird it has been for all sports, but obviously we're talking basketball here. Tell the folks what that's been like, trying to do color and follow the games for the Hawkeyes during the course of this pandemic season that's been so nuts.
Yeah, Dennis, it started, let me think, I'm a little over a year, March 12th, I think, we were at the Big Ten tournament and getting set up to maybe play Illinois, maybe Minnesota, I can't remember who it was, getting ready for the game, and they told us, well, the night before, we had been in Bankers Life Arena and saw Fred Hoiberg, who's coaching Nebraska, looked like his skin was going to fall off. We knew this virus was out here. Well, what did that mean? We had gone through a virus in the NBA with HIV, and no one knew how that was transmitted early in that. So you kind of had this, okay, you know, unknown happening once again, and wake up and, well, we're, get over to the arena. Well, once we got there, they're like, get out of here, or you're going to be staying in here for 2 weeks. We grabbed our stuff and headed back to the hotel, and that's when we got word that, you know, everything was getting shut down. Now, you know, now we're in our business is shut down, and so we go back through what we're going through. Didn't know if you get this season going. You kind of assume that they would. What the kids have done, the staffs have done, of kind of their own little bubble. I mean, that's an incredible amount of discipline, incredible amount of, you know, just staying away from your family. I mean, that's crazy. What they've had kids have had to do, what it's going to do to them mentally. I just hope, you know, everyone paying attention here to what these kids have gone through. But we were not able to travel. We didn't go through the whole testing process as the kids are doing. Fran said 6 days a week they were getting tested, all the athletes. And you know, if it was a rapid test, but if it was a positive, they get a lot of those positives in rapid tests. Then they do the PCR, and you find out the true nature. So they did a nice job of containing it whenever it would pop up. Iowa this year, you know, great expectations with Luca Garza. Wanted to be a part of it. You know, I love being on the bus with those guys. I love going to practice. I get up, you know, go down to the coffee room there, the meeting room, and you see people, and you weren't able to do that this year. And our away game days consisted of doing what you do on a normal day, and then you head to Kinnick Stadium, where Gary and I would meet Corey Sheets, our producer. He'd have big screen set up in the network television booth up on the fourth floor. So we were relying on a video feed to come in from whatever location. Sometimes that video feed went out. Sometimes the video feed, the camera wouldn't move. It would just stick on the court. It wouldn't move over to the side or what. So you just did the best you can. And it was frustrating at times. We had a floor mic, so you heard the squeak. You heard the balls bounce. You felt like you were there to people that were listening from the outside. But I hope we never have to do that again. That was just, we were hoping we could get to Indianapolis for the NCAA tournament, but right. Just too much planning and the whole testing thing, getting all that done. We had the feed drop several times, and we would go from a live feed and we'd look up to the actual, you know, TV broadcast in the suite there, but it'd be 15 seconds behind. So you'd have to kind of wait until it caught up and then see, oh yeah, you stepped out of bounds on the sideline. There were times when Gary would be calling the guy dribbling to the basket and the feed would just go blurry, blurry, blank out, and you'd have no idea what happened. And he'd look at me and I'd look at him and say, make something up. Kicked out of bounds. But then they're taking the ball out of bounds. Then you could, yeah, but you know, that's the old great Jim Zobel, late great Jim Zobel said, never let the facts get in the way of a broadcast. So
that's right. Yeah. Yeah. That kind of reminds me of it kind of reminds me of the old days when they're talking about some of the radio shows that they do the baseball, and they'd be kind of making it up as they went. They'd be getting, you know, the facts fed to them, and they're trying to make it seem like it's play by play. But yeah, that had to be frustrating, but and surreal, I'm sure.
Yeah, Reagan, when he came on WHL.
Exactly.
Notorious stories about it. He'd have the bat and he'd click it, and that's a double to the second day in the left center field. People had no idea. It was coming across the channel. That's what it was. It was coming across Western Union, and he would read it and call the play. So that's radio.
That's funny. So okay, since we're talking about the year that the Hawkeyes have had, and you mentioned Luca Garza. What happened, not just to Iowa, what had happened to the Big Ten in the tournament? 9 teams get selected. Only Michigan remains at the point that we're recording this right now.
Yeah. Huge shock. Loyola over Illinois. You know, there was a bad matchup for Iowa with Oregon. Probably a bad matchup just the way they defended Illinois. Top 3 teams, Illinois, Iowa, Michigan. Ohio State. To a little bit, I had them a little bit further in my bracket. I don't know. I just think you beat each other up during the season. I think the Pac-12 stand up, take a bow. I mean, the teams that they put in there, yeah, the athletes that they have, and now Gonzaga would be my pick probably to Gonzaga Baylor in the finals, but they're going to have their hands full with USC tonight. Yeah. Gonzaga is Michigan, UCLA is going to be a great basketball game as well. I think Michigan comes through that one, but Michigan was the best team in the Big Ten this year, and they're the ones still standing there to represent the Big Ten. But it's kind of sad. I had a day of mourning for the kids after we lost to Oregon. Tuesday was a hard, like, you know, oh, man, almost it seems like, you know, what ifs. But it's sports. I mean, they're winners and losers. The kids gave everything they had. And the sacrifice that they went through this year, they're never going to forget this year. I guarantee you that you can think. You know, what were you doing in 2020? Like, yeah, I tell you what we were doing. Nothing. We were quarantined and, you know, just had to concentrate on basketball. And then, it'll help them down as they move to their professional lives as well.
Sure. I kind of thought that if Illinois had played Oregon and Iowa had played Loyola, that would have been a better matchup for each of them.
Well, he's just mad because his bracket's busted.
My bracket's been everyone's. Everyone's bracket's busted.
I got a bunch of X's all over.
Mine's okay.
I got one final four,
When does the final four?
I'm the finals.
When is the final? Where are we right now? When is the final four?
It'll be this Saturday.
This Saturday. So you usually have tickets. Yeah, so you usually have tickets to the Final Four, right?
Do I?
Yeah, you usually do, don't you?
No, they don't. They give the coaches, and depending on their level of, you know, tenure, I guess, whether they get four or two or where they're at. But no, I went to the Final Four in 1980 and then again in 1983, my senior year. But no, I've never been back to a Final Four. Tickets are hard to come by. Other than, you know, if you know a coach, and coaches have their own people that they give them to. But I think I don't know what they're going to do this year. Hopefully they open up the Lucas Oil Stadium to a little bit more capacity. They get some more people in there.
Yeah.
That comes up. The final two games, and then you'll have your final four set for Saturday's action.
Yeah. Well, and I'm interested to see how that goes, but I think I'm with you. Seems to me Gonzaga is they will have their hands full with USC, but I like the way they're playing.
The guard, Jalen Suggs, freshman guard from Minneapolis, was a All-American high school football quarterback on top of it. So that's why I like them, the way he handles the ball.
Right. So let's talk a little bit about Luka. How do you think he's going to come out in the NBA? Any idea where he might get drafted?
No, I don't, Dennis. I've seen him. One of them I looked at a couple of weeks ago had him first round to Brooklyn, late in the first round. I think there's a place for Luka Garza and the big bodies. And I say that because we all know the game is changing more to what they now call positionless basketball. It's not the center, the forward, the shooting guard, point guard. It's like Oregon. It's five guys that are 6'4", 6'7", just running around and shooting threes and stealing the basketball and everybody helping out on the board. So the game has changed a little bit, thanks, I think, to Golden State Warriors and Steph Curry and Clay Thompson. Yeah, those guys shooting threes and the analytics of it all. It's better to shoot three than two. You know, we played basketball. We tried to get as close as you could to the basket to get closer to make a two. Now that's like discouraged. So, the three has certainly taken over the game. And for Luka, it's his hard work. It's his work ethic. No one is going to be in the gym earlier. No one's going to stay longer. He is going to be an inspiration to his teammates. See how hard he works to improve. A great kid. Mm-hmm. I would draft him on that alone. So I don't know if he's a first round pick, Dennis, but I think, you know, he should be somewhere in the second round. If not, he'll be able to pick a team that could use a big player like Luka is, with the ability to step out and make threes.
Right.
He added that to his game the last couple of years. And if all that doesn't work out over here, he'll make a lot of money overseas. As I believe his mother is a citizen of the old Yugoslavia, Croatia or Serbia. So he'll have the opportunity to play over there.
Yeah. Now we got Luka leaving, of course, and Bohannon leaving, but they have a lot of other folks coming back next year. What do you think they're going to look like next year?
Yeah, different. I don't think we'll be dumping the ball on the post as much. I think you're going to see both Murrays, Keegan and Chris, out there, and you get two guys 6'7". They will improve. I thought Keegan had a great freshman year. Jack Nungy back healthy. Hopefully Joe, you know, gets positive feedback from the NBA, but he could be our star next year. Wieskamp come back for his senior year. He may not, and we understand that. But got a young freshman out of Waukee, Peyton Sanford, who's a shooter like Jared Utoff was for the Hawkeyes. So they'll be different. They'll spread the court a little bit more positionless. I think you'll see different guys attacking. I trust Fran to get it figured out. I think all of these teams are going to be looking at all these transfers in the transfer portal now. There's over 990 of them, I think, in there. That's three per team, basically. Yeah, transfer kids getting out there. So, we've had success with transfers. Jared Utoff, Bakari Evelyn in the past. So Fran may end up looking there, but they'll be competitive, no doubt about it. The league will be a little bit different. They lost a lot of star power this year, losing Kofi Coburn and Io down in Illinois and Luka Garza. And I think Michigan's going to lose a couple of guys as well.
Probably, yeah. So I want to talk a little bit more about your day job, Better Business Bureau. It's something that I know you also take very, very seriously. And is extremely interesting to me. I've learned a lot about the Better Business Bureau the last few years that I thought I knew and had taken things for granted. Can you explain to the folks what the Better Business Bureau is and does and what your role is?
Yeah, Dennis, yeah, great to have you as a member as well. That's where you and I first met,
right?
At the Torch Awards when your firm received the Integrity Award. And I loved your opening comment where you said being a personal injury lawyer, the irony is not lost on me. Integrity Award, and I said I want to meet this guy. I gotta meet him. So that's how Dennis and I's relationship started. And but Better Business Bureau is run by Chris Coleman, our CEO, president. He's a great guy. Loves people. He just loves helping people out. And he recruited me to the BBB after I was at the Iowa Speedway when they sold and closed down for a little while. And really, you know, we're not in a good place. So was out looking for a job. Yeah, I knew I had to do something. I couldn't sit around all the time. So Better Business Bureau came calling, and I'm like, yeah, okay. Kind of forgot a little bit what they do. My mother was a big believer in Better Business Bureau and honest and integrity and transparency. And so after I met with Chris, and he was kind of thinking of a different, more of like a guy that or a person that could write press releases, a media relations person. But we ended up kind of combining several jobs into one. But the Better Business Bureau has been around for over 100 years nationally. It's now an international association. It's nonprofit. We're completely supported by our members' dues, accredited business dues. There are no outside sponsorships or anything at this point. You're graded, they grade companies from A+ to an F. They are a clearinghouse for complaints and reviews that are vetted to make sure that they are actual customers, not just a competitor trying to put a bad review up there. We make sure these things are all real on a daily basis. I take phone calls and direct them to our specialists. People in this area, Dennis, who got crushed by the contractors and that coming in from out of town. We try to make sure that they're on the up and up. We award scholarships to students of integrity. As you saw at the Quad City Torch Awards, you had four or five young students get $2,500 scholarships to advance their education. Kids that have gone above and beyond what normal high school kids would do on an integrity basis, inspiring stories. We have a nonprofit arm that called give.org, where we'll check out charities to make sure that they're real. Number one, they're not a bogus cancer charity. We work in conjunction with attorney generals that are consumer advocates. They want to know what we're hearing on the front lines, what the complaint is, what the problem is. We had a contractor here in Cedar Rapids that just seemed to, after derecho, would collect down payment for work and never get back and do the work. So normally, you know, Dennis, these are civil cases when it comes to contractor. They are now charging them criminally with felonies of taking the money. So, you know, play a small part in that. as they should. Yeah, we and they're really, really, really the worst people in the world taking advantage of people at the lowest point. They have a tree sticking through their living room, you know, and then to take a $5,000 down payment and then never show up. You're like, what do you do? So we got a ton of those calls, and they're gonna it's really gonna get ramped up here now as you know people start putting the roofs back on with the weather, and work is not gonna get done. So we are prepared for that, but we basically are a place, the BBB.org. You can go to look up a company before you hire them. Make sure that you know they've got an A plus rating. I would not want to mess. I would not even want to talk to an F or a D rated company. That's just somebody that just doesn't care. In it for all the wrong reasons. But believe me, there are companies out there like that. Not responding to complaints is the biggest area that will drop the grade of these companies. They were not always, you know, companies were not always graded by the BBB. That's only been, I think, in the last 10 to 15 years that they've done that. But my job was brought in to talk with the larger companies of in the state of Iowa, the Hy-Vees, Casey's, Pella Window, Vermeer, these big manufacturers, big grocery touchpoint places that, you know, and you have to explain, well, why should I join the BBB? Well, you're joining a network of like businesses that have the same common goal is to try to create a marketplace out there that's built on trust. We are not the police. We can't come and arrest you or beat you up or whatever I'd like to do to some of these people, but we can put them on notice that they're being watched, and we need a response. If you don't get the response, we'll do it again. And then they do turn it over to county attorneys or state attorney general.
Yeah. You know, one of these days, we've already gone on for quite a while today, and I don't want to keep you, you know, take too much more of your time. But one of these days, I've got to have you come back and talk a little bit more about the Better Business Bureau, because I did see a presentation that you did online that you talked a great deal about how scammers were really kind of taking advantage of the elderly and some other folks. And I think that'd be a great thing for our audience to hear. So I'd love to have you back to do that.
I did that presentation for the Johnson County Commission on Aging, and had a lot of good response from that. Is everybody's getting those calls, Dennis. It's crazy. And the robot calls coming through. Mm-hmm. And again, they're getting enticed to send gift cards. And in some cases, people send cash to a P.O. box. They're fearing that their grandson is, you know, going to be murdered in Mexico. He's been kidnapped. And it's just preying on people in the middle of the night. You know, and the phone rings on an elderly person. And it's the people as well, Dennis. And, you know, the data centers that are selling these people's phone numbers, age-generated lead lists. Somewhere you got to get that to stop.
Yeah. The way you have, you know, you're passionate about this the way you were passionate about basketball. And it reminds me of one of the articles I read that, oh my gosh, this was, I think, when you first went to Chicago and somebody was talking to you about potential interest in going into politics. Is that something that you would still consider doing?
No. why would anybody want to do that?
Right.
My godfather, Johnny Morrow, Polk County supervisor forever, he said it's an intoxication of power, because you can help people out in that way. You get jobs for people in certain situations. And it's like, you know, I don't have that desire anymore. I may have at a time. Remember the time I wanted to go to law school, too, Dennis, after... I think it'd be good to see our young children watching dad study, you know, in your 30s, but it just too old at that time, I think, for me and my world. But politics, I'd certainly thought about it on a local basis years ago. But after following, you know, these past 6-8 years, it's like there is no way. I mean, I don't know why anybody would want to put up with that type of dissection of your life. We've got to get past this side, that side, red, blue, you know, Democrat or Republican. It doesn't matter. It's like, you know, let's help people out here and people now in dire need. I think that's where politics needs to start to listen up and you know, wake up, I guess, if you will. And I just don't see that happening yet. Is whoever's got the majority is going to force the agenda onto these people. So, one way, reach across the aisle.
Well, you're doing good things with the BBB, so that's fine. You stay put there and do the good work that the politicians should be doing, right? So before we let you go, well, first of all, Dana, you usually have some interesting questions. You have
any? I do. So what's the best $100 you've ever spent?
Ooh. I say I just put it in my son-in-law's card. But it's got him $100
bill. Oh, that's nice. So
giving it away. Giving it away, I think. $100 doesn't seem like much anymore, but he's got a birthday coming up. My wife thinks it's cool to get a $100 bill. And so, yeah, it's fresh in my mind. I think just giving it to him, because he'll spend it on my daughter.
Who doesn't want that? Oh, that's nice. That's nice. Okay, so what's your biggest pet peeve?
I blow out my garage all the time. I just don't like bugs. And, you know, we spray around the country. We're always spraying. So I'm constantly got the leaf blower and clearing out the garage. It's probably a little bit of, I don't know, there's a disorder about that. The closet, you know, all the white shirts, black shirts, blue shirts, everything got to have an order. And I blame my wife on that one, because she is a clean freak, neat freak that has really got me doing that. So that's probably my biggest pet peeve is everything's got to be in order.
Yeah, I gotcha. So in all of your time, I'm sure you met a lot of famous people doing basketball. And you're like, how is it doing basketball?
playing basketball.
You can tell I'm a sports buff. So who's probably the most famous person you've met?
Most famous? Jimmy Buffett. How about that?
Oh, that's fun.
Ooh, I love Jimmy.
That's fun.
Yeah.
Did you ever meet?
Backstage at.
Go ahead.
Say it again.
Backstage.
I said we were backstage in Kona, Hawaii. Ed Podolak is dear friends with Jimmy Buffett. Eddie does the football for Iowa. He said, if you're ever anywhere Jimmy's at, just knock on the door and tell him you're a buddy. I'm like, I'll buy a ticket. No tickets. Sold out. 1,500 seat ballroom. So my wife is 6 months pregnant at that time with our oldest child. So I'm 31 years ago. So their T-shirt girls were selling T-shirts. So young kids. And I went up and said, hey, blah, 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 blah. The girl goes, let me go get my dad, Savannah Buffett.
Oh, my gosh.
And so she goes, follow me. Yeah. So she's like, how do you know Pody? And I said, playing golf in Iowa. And they said, that's how we know him. So come on. They slapped backstage passes on me and my wife. And I don't think she had a great time. She's 6 months pregnant. But sitting on the guitar cases and talking to people and the Memphis horns and my first Jimmy Buffett concert and just watching the man. Big fan now.
That's so fun. I love that. That's good.
That's all you got, Dana. You didn't want to ask about Bill Murray. That's her man.
This is funny. So I thought I was reading an article that you were in, and it had talked about, having tickets to all of the Big Four games.
Final Four.
Yeah. To all of the Final Four. Yeah. I don't know how that was mixed up, but I was super excited because one of the famous people they sat next to, whoever this fellow was Bill Murray. And Bill Murray is my best friend. So have you ever met Bill Murray?
No, I don't think I have. I know he's a big Chicago guy.
Yeah.
I love it. Love his work. Love Caddyshack. We were watching it the other night, laughing. But did he have a kid playing or coaching? One of his sons were coaching.
I don't even know.
I mean, he's definitely a big Chicago fan, Cub fan, Bears, Bulls, everything. I don't know about Harry, that.
Can I put Harry Carey in there too? I got to meet him.
Yes.
For sure.
I tried to find your video of where you sang, and I couldn't find it anywhere.
Yeah, I met Harry.
Take me out to the ball game, man.
Saying that, that was a different time. But this was in the day after the National World Championship. We went there, and they knew we were there, and come up and say hello to Harry and Steve Stone. So I have a Harry Carey autographed Chicago Cubs hat. He signed it in a ballpoint pen on the bill of my cap. So just a super gentleman. I grew up listening to Harry when he was doing St. Louis Cardinal baseball. Sure. Man, was a huge Cardinal fan. So listening to Harry and then Chicago's. I got to add the great Harry onto that.
Yeah.
List of famous people.
That's fun.
Yeah, that's for fun. Sure. Love Harry. Well, we're going to wrap it up with just, I think I mentioned we're going to play a little bit of Would You Rather, okay? And then we'll wrap things up here. So I've got this list here. Would you rather be compelled to high-five everybody you meet or compelled to give wedgies to anybody who's wearing green?
I'll go with the high-five. Yeah.
All right. Would you rather never be able to wear pants or have breath so bad that it makes anyone within 6 feet of you vomit?
Oh, that's tough.
Oh, no, you don't want that. You don't want that, Dennis. I'll move somewhere where I can wear shorts. Does that count as no pants?
I'll give it to you. All right. Would you rather be forced to wear just one color all day or have to wear 9 colors all day? So your clothes are either one color. You're not gonna have the multicolored Joseph in the Amazing Technicolor dream coat type of look.
I don't know. That seems
One color.
That seems very
a lot of black.
Very yeah. Jimmy Buffett-y. Yeah.
I'll wear one color, all black.
All right. That's easy. Would you rather have the police hunting you for a murder you didn't commit or have a psychopathic clown hunting you?
Jeez.
I think I could reason with the police that you got the wrong guy. So I'll go with A.
All right. Last one. Would you rather be an amazing virtuoso at any instrument, but only play if you're naked, or be able to speak any language, but only if you close your eyes and dance while you're doing it?
You have to play it naked.
All right.
I can sit there.
I like it.
We'll go with that one. Yeah.
All right. Well, Bobby, thanks so much for spending time with us. Like I said, we're going to have to have you come back and talk a little bit more about business. I really appreciate you being here. And for those of you at home, thank you all for joining us today. Again, please be sure to subscribe, rate, and review us. Also, check out our other podcast, Legal Squeaks, and you can get information for both of these the podcasts at uncommonconvos.com and legalsqueaks.com. Tune in next week when we have another great guest. In the meantime, have a great day, stay safe, and I love you all.